So, at last we are with Seifert van Kampen theorem. So, let us begin with another small preparation here. Patching up of covering spaces. Start with a group G. Let U and V be two path connected open subspaces of X, where X itself is U union V. Let P and Q be coverings, G coverings over U and V respectively. Suppose W, which is U intersection V, is path connected and there is a G map between the two coverings restricted over W, namely P inverse W, P W, Q inverse W, Q W, there is a map V. That is what? P is a homeomorphism of the top space such that it commutes with the projection maps, and indeed recall that phi of gx must be g of phi x. This is the definition of G map. Then there is a G covering tau on the whole of x. So tau is such that tau restricted to U twiddle will be P, and tau restricted to V twiddle will be Q, and the total space is exactly the union of U twiddle and V twiddle. Okay, this is the statement. So that is the meaning of these two coverings on these two open subspaces have been patched up to give a covering on the whole space X. Okay, let us see how it is done. So X twiddle is the quotient of the disjoint union U twiddle V twiddle. It is not just the disjoint union, because below U and V have intersection. So on those intersections we must have some identification, namely Z is identified phi Z for every Z in P inverse of W. Remember, this phi is a homeomorphism from P inverse of W to Q inverse of W. So for all points in P inverse of W, I identify it with its image under phi. So that is the quotient map. That is the quotient space. Okay. So by definition, X twiddle is the quotient of U twiddle disjoint union V twiddle, but see that within U twiddle there is no identification. Similarly, within V twiddle there is no identification. Therefore, under the quotient map, U twiddle and V twiddle go injectively, and we identify these subspaces of X twiddle to be U twiddle and V twiddle. In that sense, X twiddle will be union of U twiddle V twiddle. Okay. So because phi is a homeomorphism of an open subset of U twiddle to an open subset of V twiddle, remember these things are, W is an open subset because W is U intersection V. U and V are themselves open subsets in X. So their inverse images are also open subsets inside U twiddle and V twiddle. When you identify along an open subset by homeomorphism, it is very easily checked that the quotient map itself is an open mapping. So it is an open surjective, so open quotient. Okay. Moreover, there is no identification within U twiddle and V twiddle. So lambda U twiddle can be identified with U twiddle. And that's what we do. Okay, we identify U twiddle twiddle with the respective image under lambda. All right, so X twiddle is defined properly. Now, on the disjoint union, you can take P disjoint union Q from U twiddle disjoint union V twiddle to U union V, which is X. But now, because the P and Q okay, are respected by this phi. See, Q composite phi is P. Therefore, the disjoint union factors down to give you a map. Let us say, well, I have defined it as tau. This should be tau. Tau from U twiddle disjoint in U2 to X twiddle. Okay? And this itself will be a covering projection, because you can just see that if P and Q are covered evenly, say that is P is covered by evenly by open subset, by an open subset, the same thing will happen for lambda over that open subset, because everything will be inside U twiddle. Okay, same thing will be happening for under Q also, if some open subset is evenly covered by Q, and X is covered by U union V, X is U union V, so this follows that the union P, Q union Q defines a covering projection. Here in the statement I have put lambda tau, here I have put lambda, you can change this lambda to tau. Okay, so that tau is an extension of P as well as Q. Same map collapsing to, factoring down to the quotient map. So this was a fairly easy picture. The hypothesis is very important and it doesn't come freely. Okay, what you have to assume? Intersection is path connected, and suppose there is a homeomorphism of the respective things here, of the restricted coverings. Restricted coverings are G coverings, they must be isomorphic. That means there is a G map between them, that's all. So that you can patch it up along with that. The beauty of this one is, I have never actually used that there are only two open sets. You could have had X as union of a family of open sets and assumed this condition for each UI intersection UJ. And perform this quotient space construction, it will work exactly same way for arbitrary things also. Okay, this hypothesis should be for each, instead of U and V, for each UI intersection UJ, they must be path connected, and then there must be homeomorphisms like this, and under these homeomorphisms you identify them, then you get a patched up covering projection. The same proof will work. So this is what the remark here says, that if you can replace the two open subset UV by a family of open subsets, and W with the family U intersection UJ, UI intersection UJ, then the proof is identical, it will work the same way. But the problem is in getting those phi ij's which are isomorphisms on intersections. That problem is not easy. That is a tricky hypothesis there. Okay. So that extra hypothesis, if you have some extra hypothesis, then only that will come. So let us see in the usage, what is that extra hypothesis we need. Okay. So here is what we want to apply this patching up. Okay. Now let X be a union of open subsets indexed over lambda, okay, where each UI is path connected, semi-locally simply connected, so that we will have the simply connected coverings for them. That's all. Further, assume that intersection UI, UJ, for all of them is the same W, this is the extra hypothesis. For every I not equal to j. Okay, one single W which is path connected. I allow UIs to be not just two members, but any member, but all of them should intersect in the same set, same open set. Pairwise intersection must be same W. Okay, choose a base point inside W, say X naught, and let this be the base point for all the spaces involved in computing the fundamental groups. So that I will not write it down, because one single same X naught is there. X naught is in W, X naught in UI, UJs, and X naught is in X. So everywhere I am taking the base point X naught. Okay, so just saves me of writing down that element. Okay, let eta I and phi I be the corresponding homomorphisms, corresponding what induced by the inclusion maps. W is included in UI. Look at the corresponding homomorphism in pi 1. Similarly here, they are inclusion induced maps. Do not confuse them for monomorphisms. They may not be monomorphisms. That is the crux of the matter. Okay, the inclusion induced homomorphism. Then look at this collection pi 1 of X. That's a group. Eta I phi I. Okay, this becomes a diagram. What we want to show is that this is a push-out diagram. This is a statement. In other words, once you know pi 1 of UIs and the intersection pi 1 of W and their morphisms, etc., pi 1 of X can be completely determined. This has to be the push out. So this is the Van Kempen's theorem. Computing the fundamental group of the union by knowing them on each individual open subsets. So that is vaguely, but this is the full rigorous statement here. Okay. So let us go towards the proof. Take any group G. Okay. Take alpha j from pi 1 of u j x naught to g, the homomorphisms, such that alpha j eta j equal to alpha I eta I naught equal to j. So this is the data for push out. This is another push out. This is another diagram. Okay. If the original diagram is a push out diagram, then this is what it should admit: a unique homomorphism gamma here, such that these triangles are commutative. These triangles are all commutative. So this is the meaning of pi 1 of X is push out. So given such a thing, we must produce gamma. So that is our task now. Okay. So what is our tool? The tool is the classification for G coverings. All G coverings are interpreted in terms of homomorphisms from the fundamental group into whatever G that we have taken. And the correspondence is canonical. And this is what we are going to use again and very strongly now, okay? So, to get this gamma, so we are heavily using the classification theorem 8.2 along with the canonical property of mu and nu. All right. So, what are these coverings? For on each uj, there is a homomorphism from pi 1 of uj to g. This will give you a unique G covering, unique in the sense isomorphism class of a G covering. Every homomorphism gives you a G covering. Let me take that one as PJ. For each j, I take this one. Okay. Now, look at alpha j from pi 1 of uj x naught to g is the given map here, right? If you compose it with eta j, what do I have? I have it the same thing as alpha I and then eta I composite alpha I. These two homomorphisms are the same means if I take this covering and pull it back here, if I take this covering and pull it back here, they are isomorphic because the corresponding homomorphisms are the same. Okay. So, this is the hypothesis that we get. This is kind of connected thing here. If you have to come here. To come here, you need a homomorphism from pi 1. To do that, you need a base point here, common base point. Okay. So, we have done not only just a common base point, but a small neighborhood, and that neighborhood is the same for all UJ. That was a crucial fact here. Okay. All right. So now I get a covering, two covering transformations here, and there will be a phi, pij from a G map from one to the other. Then you up and get a covering over X, which restricts to these coverings when you pull back through these inclusion maps. Okay, that is the extension of this covering. That covering corresponds to a homomorphism into G. Take that as gamma. Automatically, if you take phi composite that, it is this covering, therefore that covering is given by this map, this homomorphism. So it must be this homomorphism. Okay, so we have produced a gamma with the corresponding property. Why gamma is unique? Suppose there is another gamma prime which also fits this diagram. Then what happens? If you pull that, use this composite, this one, okay, the covering given on UI will be the same thing as covering given on by this alpha I. Therefore, restricted to each UI, the coverings are the same, but UIs form an open covering for the entire thing. Therefore, the two coverings here are the same. Therefore, the map is the same. Same means what? Up to isomorphism. Therefore, the map, the homomorphisms must be the same. So, you see, that is the end of the proof. So, the proof of Van Kempen's theorem has become complete tautology here. No problems at all. Okay, I repeat here. So, what we have done? Start with such a diagram. We have to produce gamma. And we have to show that this gamma is unique. Namely, when it commutes with these diagrams. So, what we do? We take these homomorphisms and construct coverings corresponding to that. Construct means we have this mu of this alpha, mu of that one I can take. Okay, when I put them back here, because the two homomorphisms are the same, they must be isomorphic here. So take those isomorphisms and patch up all these coverings. Start with the disjoint union of these and then identify them to get a covering on X. Covering on X, now you have to go back, reverse, gives you a homomorphism. That homomorphism, when you compose with this, phi I, it's eta alpha I, which just means that if you pull back this covering over this one, it must be this alpha. So therefore, this must be alpha I. I mean, if this is alpha I, same thing as saying that pull back, this covering must be the same thing. Okay. As an immediate corollary, we will write down this one in a simpler case, namely when X is union of only two open sets, connected, path connected, okay, and the intersection is simply connected. This is one of the cases that we are interested in, okay. Assume that X is locally contractible or locally, semi-locally, simply connected and so on, so that covering spaces make sense. Then the induced inclusion-induced homomorphism, I check from pi 1 of u to pi 1 of x, J check from pi 1 of u to pi 1 of x. Why I am not writing the base point? I am assuming that the common base point in the intersection which is connected is taken, okay? Same common base point for all of them, that's why I am not writing. These are injective and pi 1 of x is the free product of their images. This is the consequence of the push-out diagram when here, when this is trivial group, this simply connected. In this trivial group, the push-out diagram is the same free product of this. And you know that these are monomorphisms. So you can identify each group GI with the free product of them. So here I am only applying two of them at a time, okay, in this theorem. You could have had any number of them. All right. So that is a simple version. So all these are, when there are several versions of Wenkampa's theorem. Unfortunately, some of them are very, very complicated. They cannot be handled directly by our classification theorem. However, whatever we have proved itself is of tremendous potential, tremendous application potential. Okay, the general form of this theorem without local contractibility or etc., but slightly other kinds of assumptions are there. Okay, you can read an excellent book of masses in algebraic topology, but even this one won't give you all the versions. There is another prototype version available in TIFR lecture notes by Dharam, algebraic topology lecture notes. These things are available on a website also, downloadable. So you can read them. And if you are working in three-dimensional topology, you need to have many other versions also. Okay, but once we have this training, you have received the fundamental relations and how things are working here, and what is the relation between covering spaces and fundamental group and so on. Those things, when you read, they will become easy for you. That's all. Okay. Just for instance, you just look at the circle S1. You can circle S1, you can write it as disjoint union of, sorry, overlapping union of say S1 minus 1 and S1 minus minus 1. Okay. But the intersection is not connected. It will contain two open arcs. All of them are trivial now. So you can think of this as U and V. They are arcs. So they are simply connected. Pi 1 U is trivial, pi 2 U is trivial. But the intersection is not simply connected. Intersection consists of two components. Okay, and both of them are simply connected. So, what is the push-out diagram? Everything is identity here. Everything is identity group. But you know the fundamental group of S1 is non-trivial. So, where did it come from? So, if you cleverly answer this, which is what Dharam does, you get a different kind of push-out diagram. Okay. So lack of time, I can't do all that now because it will go beyond course. Okay. However, let us whatever we have done, let us use that in a as you know, as cleverly as possible and carry quite a few interesting results here. So let x be 1 point union of copies of s1 index over a set lambda. 1 point union. Okay, what you call as wedge of circles. Then the fundamental group is a free group over the set lambda. In particular, its rank will be equal to the cardinality of the set lambda. How many circles you have taken? Okay, so this is an immediate consequence. All that you have to do is take the common point wherein you have identified all the circles, 1 point from each circle, let take that as x naught, the base point. Okay, pick up a point xi in the copy s1i different from x naught. Throw away all these points from x. X is the union of all these circles. Throw away all these points. That is an open set. Call that as W. Put ui equal to W union one of the element, one of the point that you have thrown out. Okay, call this as ui. If you put xi, call it as ui. That is also an open set. Okay, so for each I have defined these sets. Clearly, union of all the UIs will be definitely equal to X. And if you take UI, okay, all of them will contain this W. So their common intersection, all UI will intersect in W. Okay, so that is an open set. So now, what is W? W, you have removed all the points, 1 point from each of these S1. When you remove that point, you are left with a two open Rs, which you can collapse to a single point X0. So this you can do for each circle, which just means that W is contractible. In particular, W is simply connected. Okay. So you have the nice picture W to UIs, various UIs. In the singleton, the W pi 1 of W is 0. So that's a trivial thing. So the pushout diagram becomes a free product. Okay. So what are pi 1 of UI? In UI, what you have done? Instead of all the W's which is contractible, in one of the circles you have put back the point, so that circle appears. The rest of them is contracts to single point, so that is homotopy type of a single circle. Therefore, pi 1 of ui is infinite cyclic. So what is the conclusion? Conclusion is that the free product of this infinite cyclic group is the pi 1 of x, which is the pushout. Okay. So we get a free product of infinite cyclic groups, one for each I in lambda. That's why you can think of this as free group over lambda. Okay. So more applications we will see next time.